It's quite appropriate as a theme for a forum on migration to be talking about Caribbean movements and mobilities, because the Caribbean has to be one of the most mobile and truly crossroads of all sorts of people. In the case of Cuba, it's probably a country that even the Aboriginal people arrived there from Venezuela. And since then, you know, it has been Africans and all sorts of Europeans, and Chinese had at one point the largest Chinese community in the world outside of Asia, but also West Indians and including Haitians. And Haiti is also a country of immigration. There are Haitians in Montreal and in New York, in Los Angeles, in Europe, in the Dominican Republic, in Cuba at one point, in other islands of the Caribbean. In terms of the Caribbean basin, there is a lot of Afro-descendant populations along the Atlantic coast of Central America, Costa Rica, Honduras, Panama, that are actually descendants of West Indians, migrants from Barbados, Trinidad, Jamaica, and places like that. And we have the perfect person to tell us about that, Matthew Casey from the University of Southern Mississippi, who is the book finished? Is it out?
The book is finished. It'll be out May 5th. I just found
out. Oh, yeah. So. It's almost out of the...
I've done my part.
You have done your part. So it is a book I didn't know. I have seen pictures of it, but apparently... It's going to be out in pretty soon, and it's a deep study of Haitian migrants in Cuba during the first half of the 20th century, and the connections not only to Cuba and Haiti, those are very important, and actually one of the beautiful things about this book is that these migrants are actually agents in their own, rather than being portrayed as passive pawns or just victims of bigger forces. They're actually portrayed and analyzed as historical actors. That's one of the beauties of the book. But also paying attention to the larger geopolitical context, in this case, U.S. imperialism in the Caribbean in the 20th century. So thanks a lot for coming from all the way from New Orleans, because it's difficult to get out of southern Mississippi, apparently. So thank you, Matthew, and welcome.
All right, thank you very much. Well, it's an honor to be here, and I really want to start out in a cliche way, but by expressing my gratitude to Jose for the invitation, and also to Maya Bernstein, who made sure that every tiny detail of my arrival here and my stay in New York has been excellent. So thank you all for coming out on a rainy evening. Probably the best place to start is to remind you a little bit about the numbers. So between 1900 and 1940, approximately 200,000 Haitians migrated seasonally or permanently to eastern Cuba. This represented, depending on how you measure it, something like 6% of Haiti's overall population. And if you consider that these migrants were coming from just very specific regions, then you can understand why so many people in Haiti and also Cuba at the time were talking about this migratory movement that many fewer people today really know about. So these decades in both Haiti and Cuba are arguably some of the most formative in terms of their contemporary political and economic history. This is the height of U.S. political, economic, and we could say military and imperial control, not just in the two countries, but in the region. And so if you take even a slightly deeper look at the roots of the two countries' sort of current political and economic situations, you don't go too far before you reach into this moment. So this book started out as an effort to just understand what it was like to be a migrant in both Haiti and Cuba in this larger context of U.S. imperial control. These immigrants are invoked and discussed in almost every book on Haiti and Cuba from the time period, and yet we know almost nothing about them. What started to happen, though, as I went through the process of reconstructing immigrants' experiences, which was actually quite difficult, what I learned was that looking at U.S. imperialism from the bottom up seemed to raise more questions than answers. And it actually challenged a lot of the fundamental assumptions that I and others had about the way U.S. foreign policy worked in these two countries. And so one of the ways I describe this book is, yes, it's a story about people doing things, you know, making difficult decisions at a moment of economic flux and in, going so far as to leave their home countries. But in telling those human stories, I suggest that we reveal the inner workings and outer edges of some of the kind of fundamental structures that drove Caribbean history and societies at the time. So whether you're talking about plantation economies, ideas of race, migration policies, or even just the functioning of the imperial state, you get a much different vision of exactly how things looked when you take a glance at Haitians' experiences. Now, migration to Cuba for contract laborers was not officially permitted until 1913. But in an effort to give you a little bit of context, I really need to start my story in 1898, right? Something that's probably very familiar to many people here. In that year, the United States intervened militarily in Cuba's ongoing wars for independence, and through an amendment to the Cuban Constitution called the Platt Amendment established political and fiscal control of the island. The Platt Amendment, there are entire books about the Platt Amendment, but it's safe to say that it ensured U.S. political control both directly and often indirectly, and it also ensured that U.S. investments would be safe in Cuba, especially the growing sugar industry of eastern Cuba. The democracy that the Platt Amendment claimed to be establishing and safeguarding, of course, was not always safe. But in that year, 1898, and over the course of the following decades, though, the U.S. government dominated or sent troops to numerous other territories in the Caribbean and Central America. And so this is a time where it is a good reminder to look at how many places were affected by what we could call U.S. imperialism. Of course, Puerto Rico, Panama, and the Dominican Republic, Nicaragua, and Central America, and of course, the U.S. occupation of Haiti, one of the longest in the region, lasted from 1915 to 1934. If I were to zoom out and look in the Pacific Ocean, then we could just as easily mention the Philippines, Hawaii, Guam, and other places. So what I'm really going to talk about, though, today is Haiti and Cuba. And before I get too much into that, though, I still need to bring you into this context, right? All of these places and more were places that, after the U.S. began to influence these areas, they became perfect markets for U.S. imports. Most of these places became producers of staple crops and cash crops for U.S. companies, such as bananas, to a lesser extent coffee, and probably the most lucrative of them all was sugar. So this economic system, right, that saw sugar production thriving in many parts of the U.S.-controlled Caribbean was largely built by migrant laborers. In Cuba, Haitians were the largest group of Caribbean immigrants and the second largest overall groups of immigrants that included many thousands of people from Jamaica, other parts of the British Caribbean, China, places throughout Latin America, soldiers and skilled engineers and chemists from the United States, and many, many thousands of people from Spain as well. One of the very common trajectories of Haitian immigrants was to work in the second half of the year in the Haitian coffee industry, and then to then go spend a season in the Cuban sugar industry, and then to constantly be working between those two. What this means, and I don't think this is too much of an exaggeration, what this means, though, is you have this mobile contingent of migrant laborers who are essentially responsible for the export economies of two countries. The fact that, at least in the Cuban sugar industry, that these industries are foreign-owned and enriching U.S. capitalists is something that we need to keep in mind. The economic importance of migrants is well known, and in fact, we've known about it for a long time, and it's described quite a bit. Again, part of the reason, though, we don't know about the migrants themselves is really for two reasons. Principally, the vast majority of Haitians were illiterate. Something like 90%, according to official statistics, were illiterate. I think I found, after visiting just about every archive and library in eastern Cuba, I think I found two letters that migrants themselves wrote. One of them might have been the most anticlimactic moment of my research career, because it was an incarcerated Haitian in a Cuban prison, and I have a letter, and he signed his name and he wrote it, and he just said, "Dear warden, I really like working in the cafeteria, and I would like to continue working in the cafeteria," right? Now, there's more to it than that, and I actually analyzed that letter in the book for what it says about the nature of archives and sources. But, you know, it was like a monkey's paw finding that letter. And I really had to find other strategies. The other reason that we know so little about these immigrants is that over the course of the 1930s, many thousands of them were deported forcefully from Cuban soil. So I can go into the political and economic conditions behind that, but the short version is that over the course of the Great Depression, you have a rising tide of anti-immigrant xenophobia in Cuba. You have a series of nationalist laws and nationalist regimes culminating with the rise to power of Fulgencio Batista in 1933. And something like 40,000 Haitians were forcefully deported, and often very violently, in that period. And so even although you can still see a lot of traces of Haitian migration to Cuba, and even in the 70s there were still something like 20,000, it's just harder to sort of map traditional migrant trajectories of assimilation and things like that with this particular group. So I had my work cut out for me. And Cuban print cultures were very unkind to these immigrants, right? On the one hand, sadly, we know that immigrants are very often invoked as caricature and as monstrosity or barbarian more than as actual human beings trying to accomplish something. In the early 20th century Cuba, this was even more so for Haitians, right? Since the earliest years of the 19th century, Haitians were usually associated with black militancy as a result of the Haitian Revolution. Over the course of the 19th century, you have what could be described as a hemispheric, if not global, smear campaign against Haitians of all sorts, and this is especially true in 19th century and early 20th century Cuba. But it's more than just that, because all of these anti-immigrant sentiments, all the stereotypes about Haitians that Cubans like to tell and retell, were also touching on very fraught, very tender political debates that were occurring in the newly independent Cuba. So on the one hand, the arrival of thousands upon thousands of black immigrants were something of a slap in the face to Cuban sovereignty. Right? Most Cuban state officials declared their opposition to Haitian migration, and when migration was actually legalized in 1913, it was seen as something of an imperial imposition by the U.S. Here, the U.S. and sugar companies can just blow over these migration policies that had previously existed and do whatever they want with the people of this region. I could show you statistics, or I could just show you images from a Cuban humor magazine. The image of the American octopus comes up a fair amount in the Cuban press and political writing. So here's a pretty straightforward one, just showing the kind of quintessential Cuban peasant getting strangled by the octopus, who's also spreading its tentacles around different sugar mills, implying its ownership of land. I'm not sure if you can see that the stars and stripes are there on the forehead of the octopus, and this is a pretty standard way to interpret U.S. imperialism in the region, as this kind of top-down, multi-tentacled thing that just moves people and money around as it wants and gobbles up resources at its own will. If an affront to Cuban political sovereignty within the first decades of Cuban independence was not enough, the arrival of Haitian immigrants touched on very sensitive debates that were ongoing about race in Cuba. So the first legally arriving contract migrants from Haiti arrived in 1913. And this is only 25 years after slavery had been fully abolished in Cuba. Excuse me, 27. So if you consider that slavery had only been abolished in Cuba since 1886, then there are already ongoing processes of deciding what freedom should look like and what Afro-Cuban citizenship should actually entail. And this had created quite the debate in the Cuban press. And that debate was even more complicated because of the emergence in the 19th century of this very potent idea of Cuban nationalism. Many people are familiar with this. It's the idea that in Cuba, there's no such thing as race. The famous words of José Martí, Cuban independence leader, was, "In Cuba, we're not black, we're not white, we're just Cubans," right? In the 19th century, this was a very powerful way to mobilize different soldiers of different races against Spanish colonialism. Afterwards, one among many legacies of this idea of raceless nationalism is that any and all sort of, how should I describe it? One of the effects of this idea of raceless nationalism is that it became very difficult for Afro-Cubans to talk about race. Right? And often when they brought up ideas of race, they were just as likely to be called racist for moments when they pointed out things like inequality and discrimination. And this was not just an academic debate. Probably the most famous sort of moment in Cuba's racial history, if we want to call that, occurred in 1912. In that year, you have an all-black political party that called itself the Partido Independiente de Color, formed among Afro-Cuban veterans who were tired of being passed over for some of the best government jobs in the newly independent Republic of Cuba. So this political party formed in an effort to sort of countenance some of the discrimination on the island. First, it was declared illegal by the Cuban Congress. And then when the PIC staged an armed revolt in the spring of 1912, they were actually repressed violently by the Cuban military, which then unleashed waves upon waves of vigilante violence in eastern Cuba. So, you know, it's difficult to tell, but some people would put the death toll of this state-sponsored violence up to 10,000, and I don't think that's such an exaggeration. And in fact, many of the people who were victims of this violence were not actual members of the PIC. So that was spring of 1912, and only 8 months later, you have the first legally arriving Haitian migrants who themselves were already associated with race war coming into the island. Even in those moments when even during more stable moments of Cuban politics, the arrival of immigrants seemed to complicate ideas about race and citizenship in Cuba. So one of the favorite claims of the people who defended Cuba's idea of raceless nationalism, they said if there are any lingering inequalities from the days of slavery, those will just sort of correct themselves as Afro-Cubans become better educated and sort of engage with the trappings of civilization and modern society and stop practicing their African religions, right? So if that is one of the standard kind of apologetic arguments for Cuba's racial system, then the arrival of thousands of Haitians associated with primitivism and savagery is going to bother not just white Cubans who are apologizing for the racial system, but even some Afro-Cuban activists have to decide what stance to take. Do we distance ourselves from these migrants in order to sort of come into the fold of Cuban citizenship? Or do we use the migration debates as proof that maybe there still is some racism lingering in this country that claims to be raceless? And there's no consensus, and yet for the historian, we still have a problem, which is we know nothing about the migrants, right? So what we do as scholars is the first thing we do is we go to the newspapers. If you're writing about the Cuban sugar industry, you go to company administrators' records, which they have a lot of those in Cuba. And if you read through those, you would think that Haitians are the most culturally isolated, backwards, reviled people in Cuba. And from the perspective of Cuban cities and lettered elites, they were, right? Not even elites, just literate public. Even people who were more sympathetic with migrants tended to see them as victims of the so-called American octopus, right? They're just pawns of the sugar companies. And so one of the things that I did, which is a standard technique for historians trying to understand the experiences of illiterate people, is I went to just about every small town in eastern Cuba that had an archive. If you ever want to go to a really boring city in Cuba, let me know and I can recommend quite a few of them for you. But they're quiet places, it's a good place to get work done. So what I started doing is looking at court records. And what happened is that anytime there was any kind of crisis in an area, right? A theft, a fire, a murder, any sort of thing that brought the police there, usually one of the things the police would do is interview all the people around. And so I collected hundreds and hundreds of examples of Haitian witness testimony, because often as they were describing that thing that ruptured their day or their life, they also talked a lot about their daily life, right? And probably, you know, this is a standard technique for social historians, but it's still very effective. It also just takes a lot of time. Probably one really, really revealing example is when somebody shot a gun in the air somewhere in Las Tunas, Cuba, and they never found out who did that, but the bullet came down and tragically struck someone. And as the police are trying to figure out why somebody randomly was shot, they start talking to all these people. And what I found were you have networks of Cubans and Haitians and even people from islands like Curacao are coming together, and they're saying, well, it was his job to go gather the boniato, the food, and he was going to go buy some soap and wash the clothes. And with every kind of rupture in the daily life, you get a new glimpse into what it was like on these plantations. And so what I'm going to do with the rest of my talk is sort of describe some of the things I learned from these moments, and do that in a way that sort of sheds larger light on the way that imperialism functioned in Haiti, right? And so the big idea is that the ideas of race that we know, this so-called American octopus that sort of from the sky seems to dictate who migrates and which land is planted with sugarcane, we really need to challenge that. And I'll also try to make some interventions into global migration history. We'll see if that works. So if we're going to look at migrants' experiences, the first thing that we need to recognize is that Haitians were coming to Cuba before the US military occupied Haiti in 1915 and before the Cuban government legalized migration in 1913. And so even recognizing that already forces us to ask a whole set of questions about what's going on, right? So Cuban migration statistics from 1906 to 1913, you have numerous years where they say zero Haitians arrived. And yet census data, court records, prison records, plantation records are all showing all kinds of Haitians around, right? The marriage record in Guantanamo is full of Haitians coming in before 1913, 1912. right? And so this led me to recognize the fact that within Haiti, migration has been sort of a long-standing strategy for subsistence, for escape, for some kind of survival, much longer than companies were actually recruiting immigrants. So what we see then are two things. One is that Haiti is so mountainous, especially in the southern peninsula where a lot of migrants were coming from, that if you're going to go city to city in Haiti, chances are that you're going to get on one of the small boats that plies along the coast. And once you're in a boat, it's actually logistically easier to get to Cuba than it is to make a trek over the Haitian mountains, even a few miles inland. Right? And so even though state officials are kind of obsessing about political borders, and certainly historians are even when we're not, right? What we see then is Haitians are just going to Cuba in at least small numbers throughout the latter part of the 19th century and into the early part of the 20th century. It also forces us to sort of change the way we think about how migration was legalized. The 20th century is often considered this moment where borders became more militarized, passport systems were introduced, and essentially states tried to exert more control over who crossed the border, when, how, right? And so what happens is all the Haitians that had been going into eastern Cuba in that period were starting to get thrown in jail. As Cuba's eastern border became militarized, you have more and more people piling up in the prisons. And so then Haitian and Cuban local officials are debating what to do. What are we going to do with these people? We need to send them home. Who's going to pay to feed them? Who's going to pay to send them home? And now what, right? And so one of the really interesting things is that you actually have local officials, consuls, and even migrants themselves requesting for permission for Haitians to just stick around for a harvest or two, pay off the prison, and then get sent back to Cuba. Get sent back to Haiti. If you read the Cuban presidential decree of 1913 that did allow migration, you actually see how different aspects of the policy were influenced by these local debates. And that means it wasn't just sugar company pressure that was pushing the legalization of migration. You also have a certain amount of input from incarcerated Haitians themselves, right? And so the first presidential decree legalizing migration said that sugar companies were going to be responsible for paying for all the costs of the migrants if they were to become a public charge. One of the big implications of that is that they would deport these people if anything came up, right? Over the course of the next migration decrees, you have more and more explicit calls for companies to deport these migrants in the event that they became a public charge. Later, that same migratory movement was legislated on the Haitian side. And again, what we see are layers of migration policies always responding to Haitian actions, calling for stricter and stricter regulations about how and when they should sign contracts, whether or not they should get passports and vaccinations, and what they would do after the sugar harvest ended. The reason this is interesting in the realm of global migration history is because this very moment, the 19-teens and 20s, represents the time when around the world, states are starting to experiment with what we might call now guest worker programs, right? The most famous guest worker program is the Bracero program of the 1940s that brought Mexican agricultural workers to the United States. And the way people tend to write about guest worker programs, they're seen as sort of like a coup for companies and states, right? The idea is that you have two countries engaging in this agreement to bring migrants there from one place to another temporarily and then send them home after the labor is done. The idea is that the companies are happy because they get their cheap workers, and that the anti-immigrant voices are appeased because then they can rest assured that these immigrants are not going to stick around once the work is finished. What's so fascinating about the guest worker program that eventually emerged between Haiti and Cuba is that, first of all, it's definitely being influenced by migrant actions, right? There's this constant cat and mouse game trying to prevent fraud. Migrants are doing anything they can to avoid having to pay extra passport fees, having to get a vaccination if they don't need to. And they're constantly just trying to travel to Cuba without having to follow these regulations, which entailed more costs than protections for them. But it's also interesting because the migration legislation was being instituted separately in Haiti and Cuba. And so we think of these two places as being sort of within this imperial sphere. And yet Cuban officials and Haitian officials, some of them are actually American Marines, are not really talking that much to one another, not nearly as much as you think, right? And so this program emerges not from some top-down swoop where sugar companies and state officials come together with a map and figure it all out, but it's more these layers and layers of migration legislation that are constantly being tweaked and modified by local officials on the ground. So this means that whatever type of guest worker program may have emerged, it was definitely haphazard and they were sort of learning as they went along. What's even more fascinating though is because they were constantly tweaking the policies, that also means that they were responding to migrants' actions. And so in this way that we're not accustomed to thinking about global trends and migration history are actually being heavily influenced by people just doing what people are good at doing, right? Which is avoiding unnecessary burdens and things like that. So by the 1920s, Haiti had what we would consider a guest worker program that on paper at least was on the global cutting edge, right? Unfortunately, like many guest worker programs that still exist today, the extra regulations on migrants did not protect them from abuse, and especially in the case of the Haitians who went to Cuba, it just was more costs and actually more opportunities of fraud for different officials. Another thing to consider is the timing. I'm not sure how good this image is, the timing of migration itself. So here you have migration starting in the southern peninsula of Haiti for reasons that I sort of briefly mentioned before. And this was the migratory movement that was incredibly hard to legislate. There were enough sort of dense networks that were really good at bringing people back and forth that was always a difficult one to insist that migrants had contracts and things like that. But once the guest worker model was actually established, then companies started to recruit specifically from the north of Haiti. And so even though you have these sort of two sets of policies being organized in Cuba and Haiti, even within Haiti, people are migrating under very different conditions. And probably another sort of observation about the workings of empire in Haiti is that the most famous aspects of U.S. control in rural Haiti, So once I managed to figure out where migrants were actually coming from, I realized they were coming from the regions of Haiti that we knew the least about during the occupation. So what we have here is essentially a map that shows the location of the most famous anti-occupation rural rebellion that took place in Haiti. So in the region in and around Inche, you have a nationalist rebellion trying to kick the occupation out. In Haitian historiography, it's called the Caco Rebellion. And this is what people always talk about. Because before the rebellion broke out, you have forced road building projects. The peasants sort of rose up and for 2 years waged a fairly successful guerrilla war against the Marines that was only solved by using the US Air Force and actually ambushing one of the leaders. And so if you want to understand the violence of the occupation, or if you read a book about the US occupation of Haiti, you're going to see a lot about the road building projects and a lot about the CACO rebellion. The problem is that whether you're looking at the northern movement of migrants or the southern movement, neither of those are occurring anywhere near the CACO rebellion. So what was actually going on there? And what I found out is that even things that we would consider to be pretty innocuous aspects of US empire were quite disruptive to Haitian peasants, right? So one of the big problems was that food was becoming even scarcer in already scarce regions because Marines were coming in and buying up everything at local markets. Outside of Port-au-Prince, you had one Haitian lodge a complaint because he had always had this sort of milk business where cows could graze on these fields, but then the officers came and turned those fields into a golf course, right? And so here you have things that we don't consider to be in and of themselves violent, which is establishing a golf course or just going into a market and buying it, are highly disruptive for Haitian livelihoods. Probably even more disruptive were things like observation towers and different kind of surveying equipment, which were always just built wherever the Marines wanted to put them. And you have numerous cases showing up in the archive where they're just plowing through a garden or some kind of subsistence plot. Usually if the Haitians responded in any kind of way, they would either fire upon them or somehow try to scare them off, right? So if you consider migration in Haiti to be sort of this survival strategy or one of the tools that you use when life is squeezed, then it makes sense that even fairly benign US policies are very disruptive on Haitians. One of the things that I did not mention is that one of the big debates about Haiti under the occupation was whether or not any land actually changed hands, right? And this is open to discussion. What we do see is that some migrants actually came back to their regions of origin and purchased land. But at the very least, what we're seeing is land being commodified and taxed and rented in this way that it never had been before. So again, even sort of basic things that we would consider standard state building procedures were much more traumatic to some of the people involved. As a result, though, you can also see that migration was not the only thing that Haitians did. This is also the time when rural-urban migration to Port-au-Prince really increases. And so you have some members of households going to cities, some actually joining the new Haitian military that the US Marines established, and some going to Cuba or the Dominican Republic. But again, just looking at migrants sort of forces us to ask new questions about what empire looked like. Probably the majority of the book actually takes place in Cuba, though. And what we know about sugar production in Cuba in the 19th and 20th centuries, and not just in Cuba, is that administrators sought to establish a kind of racial division of labor on the plantations. So just to give you a sense, a sugar plantation, if for anybody who doesn't know, is a pretty mechanized, highly technological process, right? So people famously refer to sugar plantations as factories in the field because you'll have just what seems like an ocean of sugar cane surrounding a highly mechanized mill that almost looks more like a steel mill than something that you would associate with an agricultural process. And so cut sugar cane has to make it into the mill within a 24-hour period. Once it's inside that mill, brought by unskilled laborers from the field, it's usually brought in and chemists and engineers are watching temperatures and spinning it on a centrifuge, and the cane undergoes a number of different technological processes to go from the kind of tall green stick to the white powder. And according to kind of best practices for sugar administrators, what you wanted to do was to segregate your workforce according to racial, ethnic, or national lines. So ideally, a sugar administrator, and they attempted to do this even in the age of slavery by having Africans of different ethnic groups in different spots on the plantation, ideally you'll have some people cutting cane, and they're bringing that sugar cane to somebody else from a different race or nationality, and they may not even speak the same language. And so every time the sugar cane changes hands, it's changing hands between groups who might not have any kind of affinity towards one another, right? This is a very standard discussion of plantations in the Caribbean, but definitely sugar plantations. And in fact, a lot of sugar administrators sort of constantly made the claims they were doing this. They purposely tried to keep Chinese in one place, separate from the Cubans, separate from the Haitians, right? And in that kind of racial hierarchy that comes up in the Haitian, in the Cuban press, Haitians are seen as the quintessential cane cutters. The problem is that this is really just administrative fantasy, more than life on the ground on sugar plantations. And so even though administrators are saying the Haitians over there, we have numerous cases where the Haitians over there actually were referring to people from Haiti, Martinique, and Cuba, right? And so it was just easy to call any poor black cane cutter a Haitian when that wasn't really necessarily the case. And again, work accident reports become crucial for understanding these dynamics. And so if you actually look, when somebody gets hurt on a sugar plantation and the administrator is forced to write a report, and at least in certain years, submit it then to the government, what you see is that Haitians and Cubans and immigrants from the British West Indies are often working next to one another in different parts of the plantation. So it is true that Haitians are numerically concentrated in cane cutting, but you also have Haitians in some of the most skilled positions of the mills, and you have a lot more diversity on the workforce at almost every rung than you would imagine. But again, these administrators are not sociologists or anthropologists. The sugar is being produced, but so is the racism, and so is the distortion of what actually happens on the ground. So if this kind of perfect hierarchy is something of a managerial fantasy, things get even more interesting in the days and hours outside of work, right? So what I saw is that however much interaction there was across racial or national lines during the workday, when workers came together and either drank or fought or had sex or did anything that people do in their off time, the amount of interracial interaction is incredibly high. And so it's not uncommon to hear about a Haitian worker who buys his lottery tickets from a person from China, his food from a Jamaican cook, and then might have a Cuban girlfriend. And so a lot of this project is about all those things that workers do to either cope with the difficulties of work or even just to make a little bit more money. And so when I do this, you also see women and children playing a much more sizable role on the plantations, even though they're not necessarily on the payroll. So children could go into the mills and sell things or bring food to parents, right? Women are very prevalent in these court records, even though they're almost nowhere to be found on sugar company payrolls. So what's challenging about this is you only see what you can see, right? You get glimpses one at a time of people cooperating to cook food or prepare food or fight or do whatever it is that they're doing. And yet, if one court case doesn't tell you that much, once you start getting 20, 30, 40, and more, then you can actually start to see a world developing that the administrators don't see and that the newspapers don't see as well. And that has some pretty big ramifications, because one of the really fascinating things, something that I expected to see and didn't, was specific statements about race and racism among workers. Right, so I learned a lot of Cuban insults and slang when people were detailing the types of fights that occurred among workers, and yet racial epithets are almost entirely absent, even from the fights that cut across national lines. And in fact, I mean, I haven't actually counted, but there are just as many fights between Haitians as there are between Haitians and Cubans, right? Or, you know, there's a moment where there is a fight among two Cubans, right? And they're fighting. And then a Haitian and a Martinican who work with these people are breaking it up. And then one of the Cubans' mother gets very upset, and so the Haitian goes in and comforts her and walks her back to the home, right? And this is just the kind of stuff you don't see in the Cuban print cultures, in the newspaper or the company administrators. And so one of the sort of big overarching arguments here is that race in Cuba, for as much as we've sort of analyzed how it worked, really we only know about a small sliver of human experience in Cuba. And once you start to get into the countryside, we start to see that things like the absolute control of the companies, or even the way that race functioned on the ground, are significantly different than what we're accustomed to reading about. And in fact, one of the biggest challenges of this project for me was I had to keep unthinking all the things I learned in preparation for my comprehensive exams, right, as a graduate student. And so I wanted to support more of that secondary literature, but it was amazing at how it kept coming out. I forgot to share this image. If you want to see the sort of very caricatured vision of what race management was supposed to look like on a plantation, I threw in an anarchist for Jose as well. Here you see the kind of Cuban manager separating the kind of caricature of a cane cutter from the caricature of a labor radical. So I think I'll leave it at that, and I'd be really curious to hear your questions. And again, I appreciate everybody coming out tonight. And I'll put the book cover up tonight. Any questions? Yeah. Go ahead.
Thank you for the talk. Excellent work. I'm curious about the connection between trade policy in the United States in Cuba and Haiti. April Merlot has a book which you're probably familiar with, Sugar and Civilization, when she argues that the kind of evolution of US trade policy and what she argues is kind of sugar imperium, right, which involves Cuba, in her case, and the Philippines, and mostly Cuba and the Philippines. There's some of them, I think, Puerto Rico, right? She argues that tariff policy is constructed in relationship to migration questions, racial ideology, how sugar refiners in the U.S. think of sugar workers outside of the continental U.S., and on and on and on. I'm just curious, did you see at all any way in which trade policy is being discussed in relationship to questions of Haitian migration?
So at the kind of regional level, yes. And one of the dangers of talking about the sort of effects of local conditions, you know, local debates about incarcerated Haitians influencing migration policy, is that I don't want to overstate that power, right? I think the way I formulate that in the book is if sugar companies were responsible for the fact of legalization, which is different from the fact of migration, that these sort of on-the-ground problems are influencing what that legislation actually looked like. There's an entire chapter in the book about the Cuban coffee industry, which essentially had not been economically important since the 1830s in Cuba. But what happened is so many Haitian migrants come to Cuba with coffee growing skills, and when they start to amass a little bit of capital in the form of wages, many of them actually go and lease or purchase land in eastern Cuba, and they start to grow coffee, which you can do with much less capital. Coffee plantations are also very friendly towards women and children workers, and so you have entire Haitian families establishing themselves in the coffee zones. The reason this matters is that by the late 1920s, the Cuban government decides that maybe if they put in a protective tariff on their coffee, they can actually produce enough coffee locally to supply local demand, right? And so when sugar prices are falling in the 1930s and everybody's calling for the deportation of migrants, you actually have Cuban coffee growers saying, we really need to keep the Haitians here. And in fact, I go into this longer discussion about how sort of local configurations and debates about race and nationalism are different in the coffee zones. And so every time they're talking about Haitian migration as coffee becomes more important, it becomes intertwined with that discussion of trade. So I'm a firm believer that migration and trade debates tend to intertwine. I think there's a lot of scholarship on that. What I am trying to show, though, is that, you know, while companies especially sort of are able to see it broadly, it's amazing at the way that local officials really sometimes are only looking at their own country. I mean, there's some high-ranking U.S. officers in Haiti who say we can't have migration to Cuba anymore. It's just damaging Haiti, which is, you know, it gets into these larger questions about, you know, how we envision empire. Because for us, it's very easy to say this is all empire, but even during the U.S. military occupation of Haiti, there's this kind of fiction of Haitian sovereignty, and it seems clear that some U.S. officials, we could say it's in bad faith, actually firmly believe that that was the case. And again, that's part of what the book is trying to do, is look at some of these contradictions. And it's a story about people that makes a lot of broader observations about empire. So thank you.
I was looking for the microphone, but we don't have it, so feel free to ask. Well, I have two questions, I guess. One is, now that you mentioned coffee, if you plant coffee trees, it takes like 4 or 5 years for those trees to produce coffee, right? So how would they live in those 4 or 5 years, right? And I think that maybe, I don't know if that is the case, but depending on where the coffee is grown, if it is grown on the hill, you can actually grow crops under the trees or whatever. So you can combine commercial and subsistence agriculture, and that's what allows them to wait. So I don't know if that is the case. That would be interesting.
So, I mean, what this is getting at, though, is that, so the coffee industry is tough because it was never as economically important as Cuba as sugar was. And so even secondary scholarship on coffee in Cuba, there's only one book on the 20th century written in the 1950s. But it did allow subsistence, and especially for entire families. One of the things that I realized, though, is some of the sources that I do have show how much labor was actually involved in that, right? So it was very easy for Cubans at the time to sort of paint coffee as this magical place for everybody, you know, a very pastoral view of coffee as being the most benign crop there is. But then if you consider that you have women and children who are working for free, and that you have a lot of family conflicts sort of sublimating what we might consider traditional class conflict, then it gets a slightly different version. So it definitely afforded autonomy, and it was also a long process of maturation for those trees. It was not without hardships for the workers, and yet there does seem to be a pretty stable group of coffee growers of Haitian descent in Cuba. The sad thing is, though, that for some years they were able to avoid deportation because of their connections to the coffee industry, but once the Cuban government passed a minimum wage for coffee pickers in Cuba, then they just decided that plenty of Cubans were going to be able to come in, so they deported them anyway. But some officials said, but what if picking coffee is actually a skill? And so what they did is they deported the coffee growers, but just kept them at the docks, essentially in prison, just waiting to make sure that the coffee harvest was still going to occur. So, I mean, with everything that might seem like a benefit or some kind of survival strategy, it was almost always coming with a lot more work or various types of exploitation. And so the kind of cat and mouse game between companies, state officials and migrants is very revealing, but it's not happy and fun, even though you're talking about migrant agency, if that makes sense. So.
Yeah, and the other one was about Jamaicans, right?
Uh-huh.
The other big group, immigrant group is the Jamaicans, and in the official sources, in the press and in the written sources, right? Jamaicans are often seen as highly educated, almost the opposite, the antithesis of Haitians, right? Haitians are illiterate and backward, and Jamaicans are advanced. In the non-official sources, it's covered the unnerving that you're doing, right? Do you see a different perception?
So for me, it's always about scale, right? Because in Havana and from a certain distance, there's always a big obsession with the difference between Haitians and Jamaicans. When you start to get to Eastern Cuba, some people will just call all immigrants Haitians, or one journalist referred to, you know, Jamaicans, people from China and Spain and Haiti all coming in. They just say, oh, Oriente, Eastern Cuba is becoming Haitianized, even though you have all these different people coming in. One of the things that I did see is when I reconstructed labor hierarchies, which you don't see everybody, you just see the people who got hurt, that there are fewer Jamaicans cutting cane than Haitians as a percentage. So certain aspects of that hold true, but not in any way like we've come to expect. The other sort of interesting thing is this question about consular representation, because for the longest time, people just assumed that Jamaicans and people from all the British West Indies did so much better in Cuba because they could appeal to their consuls. But actually, some recent scholarship by Bob Whitney and some other people has shown that, in fact, that consular representation was not quite forthcoming. And I think one of the things that this book does is that when we look at Haitians in these sort of, we'll call them unofficial spaces, then you actually learn a lot more about Cubans and Jamaicans as well. So, I mean, if you're a sugar worker in Cuba, only the most egregious things are going to give you consular representation, whether your citizenship is Cuban, British Empire, or Haitian. I mean, it's not going to be that helpful for anybody, and really, the much more common strategy is just sort of subsistence or different types of survival techniques and some labor mobilization as well, right? So, I mean, I think the advantages are less pronounced than what some of the things you might imagine just from looking at the consular correspondence. But you do see that they're not identical in the labor market, though. Jamaicans are just as a percentage less likely to cut cane, even though there's plenty in there.
Yeah, I'm a little puzzled about which languages are being either spoken or written in, because there are problems of concepts and overlapping different legal traditions. And I wondered how many different languages you had to master in order to try and get into these various records.
So the vast majority of the sources I read were in Spanish or French or English. Occasionally, Haitian sources are in Creole. I know enough Creole to get in a cab in Haiti and just sort of do some very basic things. But linguistics is really fascinating. So if you look at citizenship records for Haitians in Cuba, when people ask you, well, what ship did you come in on? Imagine I'm going to tell you the name of a ship, and then I'll tell you the different ways that it's spelled depending on the language of the state official. So an English ship called the Wanderer is said out loud by somebody with a kind of more francophone accent, and you could imagine them saying Wanderer or something along those lines. And then in Cuban sources, it's spelled as Juan Dore. So the first name of a man, Juan, and then D-O-R-E, right? And so there are specific ways that certain Haitian cities are inscribed in official documents. One of the most fascinating things for me was the surnames in Haiti. And this makes it all the more difficult to track individual migrants because so many Haitians in Cuba have the last name of Fils, F-I-S or F-I-S-S, P-A, P-I-E, or Pol, P-O-L. I have never seen any of those three surnames in Haiti. What it was, though, is that's how Cuban officials were inscribing what they heard. So Fils, F-I-L-S, just means junior or son of in Haiti. And so as people are leaving their local neighborhood where they just say, you know, Jean-Claude Fils, I'm the son of Jean-Claude or Jean-Claude Junior, then that actually gets turned into a proper name as F-I-S or F-I-S-S in Cuba. You know, there's also the Barbadian prison record I looked at where they said name was what you name, you know? And so much of what's happening is, it can be frustrating, but once you recognize that what you're watching is state building in the process and you know, turning these local identities into the sort of those crafted and recognized by the state, things get much more interesting. And so, you know, avoiding state officials was one thing that Haitians could do in Cuba, and it makes it almost impossible for the scholar to really track them down. I mean, I have so many different Jose Pols that, which I think is the name Paul, you know, that it's just sort of mind-boggling. And so, and that also meant that it was difficult to enforce contracts. And one of the things companies would do is they had to put in deposits for each of the workers they contracted, but when it was time to send them back, they had no way of knowing who was who, right? Which Jose Pol is that Jose Pol? So they would often just say, we have more work here, and as people showed up, they would just throw them on the boat. I mean, it was awful, the things that they did. But that's, you know, that's what we're seeing is sort of the imperfections of the Cuban and Haitian and by extension the U.S. imperial state. And so my frustrations with I can't find these migrants, I can't figure out about their lives turned into, oh wait, there's a larger commentary about the problems of Cuban or Caribbean print cultures and archives and state institutions, which is what the book is supposed to be doing, right? So I turned my frustrations into arguments, I guess you might say. But it was very frustrating. And like, it truly was anticlimactic when I found the letter from the guy who was in jail who just said, you know, I want to work in the cafeteria still.
But imagine how important it was for that guy to work in the cafeteria.
No, of course, yeah. And that's in the book. I talk about him working in the cafeteria, right? But yeah. But still, you know, I was hoping for an autobiography or something, but no life story. Yeah.
So in terms of one more sort of question about the language, do we see most of the Haitian immigrants learning some level of Spanish, or are we remaining insular enough that they don't need to, or?
So both, right? People of the Caribbean are always better at mastering languages than scholars. A lot of the witness testimony I have was taken via the help of an interpreter. And most of the times when somebody does testify in the courts or to the police, they had to explain whether they were literate and whether or not an interpreter was present. So very often interpreters were present, but not always, which is why, you know, it it gets really fascinating to think about how those linguistic divisions worked on the ground. And I have to be honest, that's something that I only have glimpses of. One of the things about this is, for all the insights I have about immigrants' lives, there's so much that I just can't know. And you're not the first to ask about the actual mechanics of mastering a new language and what that looked like. And the mechanics of it I don't see, but I can give you the typical throwaway response. Some people did it, but not all of them, right?
But also, I mean, the fact that Spanish was the lingua franca. I mean, the Chinese and the Haitians and the Jamaicans could only understand each other in Spanish. They were used, which was also the same with African slaves. The Spanish was the lingua franca, mm-hmm. not Yoruba or
yeah.
That also helps in multilingual settings. Mm-hmm.
And some Haitians did have Spanish language inscriptions tattooed on their arms and bodies. Again, what you can see is astounding because prison records pay attention to tattoos, and yet I can't just do something as basic as say, do you consider yourself bilingual, right? But there's definitely a certain mastery of Spanish there. And in fact, some people may have actually achieved a little bit of literacy in Cuba as well, because the more, as more migrants were taking multiple trips, that correlates with higher rates of migrant literacy. And in fact, the migrants who I did see as being connected to organized labor in Cuba were more likely than not literate. Which for me, it went past the realm of coincidence. There's quite a correlation there, so.
Do you know, it seems like the Haitians that are going to Cuba are from different regions than the Haitians that are going to the Dominican Republic. Is that possible?
So some of, I think so, actually. Let me pull the map back. Yeah, so I'm not sure exactly where the ones going to the DR are. I mean, you know, people like Richard Turrets would claim that there's this whole wide frontier zone and it's not entirely clear. I do know that the ships that went to and from Haiti also stopped over in the Dominican Republic. And there are moments where you have Dominicans who also, some of them migrated to Cuba. You have Dominicans and Haitians on a boat together going back to Haiti. Some, but not all of the Haitians get off, and then some Haitians then go to the Dominican Republic. So there's actually ample evidence that some people spent time in all three places. I say ample. I mean, for this kind of project, ample is like, I won't, you know. couple ships records, couple individual life stories, but I mean, it was happening for sure.
Okay, we can continue the conversation. I think there is still something to eat. And drink back there, so thanks a lot.
Thank you, everybody.